When you're a kid, it can be really difficult to stand out from your peers. That's why a musician is using his lucky fin to help children realize that we're all different in our own special way. Hannah Deenan has a story. Na, 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 na,
na, na, na, na. It would be a challenge for most people to hold the attention of a room full of kindergartners.
You remember this part?
Yeah.
I've got this fin, and you should see me swim.
But not for Tony Memel.
I've got this fin, and you should see me swim. Every voice. I've got this fin, and you should see me swim.
He's got this fin, and he's using it to play music with a message.
A lucky fin doesn't necessarily just have to mean a hand or limb difference. It's about we're not all going through the same thing, but we're all going through something.
The term lucky fin comes from Disney Pixar's Finding Nemo.
How's the lucky fin?
Lucky.
Nemo is a fish, the main character of the film, and he was born with a small fin. And in a way, he's become sort of a hero for kids today, born like me with lucky fins.
For one boy in particular in this sea of singers, Tony is the true hero.
I got this fin, and you should see me swim. I like music because of Tony.
This is Harvey. He's 5 years old, and he's had to answer tough questions about his lucky fin his entire life.
I was born this way. I told him that.
Harvey's mom, Barbara, hopes having Tony come to the school will make things easier for her son.
They can see Tony and say, like, oh, yeah, Harvey can do whatever. Because look at Tony, he's here playing a guitar, traveling the world playing guitar.
Music with a message of acceptance.
How great you are.
Oh. And resilience.
Well, you know this part. I am never, never, never gonna give up.
Striking a chord with young hearts and minds.
Never gonna give up. I am never, never, never gonna give up. Never, never.
What a great story there. Well, that's it for KPRC Channel 2 News at Midday. Thanks for joining us. The news at noon starts right now.
Live from KPRC, this is Channel 2 News at Noon.
Right now at noon, walking away from what could have been a deadly shooting, an attempted robbery at a gas station ends with shots fired. The victim speaking to Channel 2 after that frightening ordeal. Plus, getting answers after a rough night at the polls for many Houstonians. Voters forced to stand in long lines well into the night and early morning. Coming up, the response from county officials. And a severe thunderstorm watch coming to an end at this hour, but the threat of showers looms as we make our way into the afternoon. Good afternoon. Thank you for joining us. I'm Sion Rhodes. That rain is expected to last for a little while longer. Channel 2 meteorologist Justin Stapleton, and now the time it all out for us. Justin.
Yeah, next couple hours probably is what we're looking at this point. Although we do still have a severe thunderstorm warning, we got a system up near, or I should say a cell, that is up near Montgomery that's getting a little aggressive on the north side there. So let's jump in a little tighter on that and show you what we've got. That's working its way towards Lake Commerce, basically on the lake at this point. That'll be moving up into Huntsville, I'd say, in probably the next 20 minutes. It's moving at about 30 miles an hour. Wind gusts upwards of 50 miles an hour. And of course, not only that, we've seen a little bit of hail with that too. This hail marker has gotten a little more aggressive right across Montgomery. If you were downtown or in the city of Montgomery, probably did see some of that M&M size hail falling. That's now moving over Lake Conroe. There's a lot of lightning with it too. So if you're there, if you're in New Waverly, you live just north of Willis along 75, heads up, hunker down for about the next 20 minutes as that system moves on through. Elsewhere though, this whole line is falling apart very quickly. We're looking at some light rain across the Katy area around Jersey Village down to Rosenberg. If you're in that, just sort of heads up. And then moving the same thing over towards Cinco Ranch. Next 15 minutes, you'll see some moderate rainfall move on through. Now, we're not done because the low itself is way over here in West Texas. So this is going to slowly wind through the state tonight. So there are additional chances for rain. I don't think it's going to be anything severe, Sion. It's more of just an annoyance and an inconvenience is probably the best way to put it. We'll talk about the rest of the afternoon and also what we've got in store. A real nice payoff once this is out of here.
Justin, thank you. The polls are closed and the ballots are in for Decision 2020, but folks across the Houston area still demanding answers after trouble at the polls. Hundreds standing in line for hours waiting to cast their vote, some in line well past midnight. Channel 2's Vincent Crivelli has the response from the Harris County Clerk's Office and from Houston Mayor Sylvester Turner.
Sion, good afternoon. Many voters were forced to wait hours to cast their ballot, many frustrated, and this morning Mayor Turner spoke out.
Super Tuesday stretched into Wednesday morning with lines around the block at TSU and other voting centers. This man says he waited 6 hours and 20 minutes to vote.
I want to get my vote in, to voice my opinion. And I wasn't going to let none stop me.
Mayor Sylvester Turner venting his frustration this morning.
I want to thank the voters who endured the long lines, and they were long lines, and waited hours to vote at Texas Southern. I think they were voting at 1 a.m.
Election officials say a big problem was the distribution of voting machines between political parties at voting centers.
So we started out equal. Now, as the day went on and we saw that the Democratic turnout was much larger, we were constantly bringing in more equipment to several locations.
The TSU voting center had 8 voting machines, but the turnout was so high, election workers brought 14 more.
It was long. It was real long. A lot of people walked away.
The issue, some centers weren't expecting so many voters under the new countywide polling place program. And another problem, a software glitch at midnight temporarily shut down voting machines.
So this is just a reminder that come November, you know, I think it's important to have plenty of voting machines that are working around the entire county.
And despite the long lines at TSU, most voters stayed positive, saying they were happy to exercise their right to vote. Reporting downtown, Vincent Crivelli, KPRC, Channel 2 News.
Developing in the race for the White House, former New York City Mayor Michael Bloomberg has dropped out of the race following a less than ideal performance on Super Tuesday. Meanwhile, the biggest Super Tuesday state, California, is still too close to call. With 79% of votes counted, Senator Bernie Sanders is leading with nearly 34% of the vote, closely followed by former Vice President Joe Biden. Karen Kaifa has the latest from Washington, D.C.
The results of Super Tuesday continue to shape the dynamics of this presidential race. Just this morning, former New York City Mayor Michael Bloomberg announced that he is abandoning his bid for the White House and he will be backing Joe Biden. Joe Biden, his political fortunes turned considerably just in the last few days. He went from people questioning whether he could pick up a single state win in South Carolina on Saturday to winning at least 9 states last night.
A super turnaround for Joe Biden's presidential bid.
Things are looking awful, awful good.
The former vice president riding Saturday's win in South Carolina and a wave of late endorsements to victory in 9 states, including a surprise in Texas.
Just a few days ago, the press and the pundits had declared the campaign dead.
But the Democratic primary contest is far from a done deal, says Bernie Sanders.
I tell you with absolute confidence, we are going to win the Democratic nomination.
Sanders posted wins in Colorado, Utah, and his home state of Vermont. With Biden and Sanders dominating the outright wins, the other candidates sought to pick up delegates to keep their bids alive. Former New York City Mayor Michael Bloomberg scored 1 Super Tuesday win in American Samoa, but decided it was not enough to continue. He ended his bid Wednesday morning and endorsed Biden. Elizabeth Warren could not boast any victories, even in her home state of Massachusetts, where Biden prevailed. Still, she vowed to continue on.
I was not born a politician, but I was born a fighter.
But on Wednesday, she too was conferring with advisors about the path forward, according to one of her aides. The next contests on the calendar are Tuesday, March 10th in Idaho, Mississippi, Missouri, North Dakota, Washington State, and Michigan, a crucial general election battleground.
And Michigan is where Elizabeth Warren was campaigning last night. Still questions as to what Warren will do next. As for Michael Bloomberg, he'll hold a press conference later on this afternoon. He has spoken with the vice president. He offered to give him any help he needs moving forward with his campaign. Live in Washington, I'm Karen Kaifa. Now back to you.
Well, the polls may be closed, but there are several local primary races that are heading to a runoff. In the 2nd Congressional District, Representative Dan Crenshaw ran unopposed in the Republican race, but his challengers still need to be hashed out. Seema Levajar-Dion and Elisa Cardinal are headed into a runoff. And the 22nd Congressional District also contested. Conservative activist Kathleen Wall and Fort Bend County Sheriff Troy Nails were the top vote getters. They are now headed for a runoff as well. The winner of that race will face off against Shreve Preston Kulkarni. In Fort Bend County, Sheriff Troy Nails' twin brother, Trevor Nails, won the Republican Party ticket for the seat his brother is about to vacate. His challenger, undecided, Jeanine Hughes and Eric Fagan are also headed for a runoff election to determine who will get the Democratic Party nomination. In the race for Harris County Sheriff, Democrat Ed Gonzalez is the incumbent and won against Jerome Moore and Harry Zamora. On the Republican side, a runoff as well. Joe Dana taking 49% of the vote and Paul Day had 29%. We've got much more election coverage on our website, click2houston.com. Head there to see updated numbers and the key takeaways from last night's races. First on two, a man walks away with a minor wound after being shot during an attempted robbery in Southwest Houston. That violent attack at the Shell station on Southwestern Imogene, all caught on camera. Channel 2 Sofia Ojeda has details.
Eduardo Flores is lucky to be alive this morning. He pulled up here at the Shell gas station this morning to pump gas like he does every day at pump number two. Surveillance cameras catching it all go down when a man points a gun in his face. Moments later, he was shot. Eduardo Flores showed police his bullet wound at the Shell gas station on South Gessner moments after he was attacked by two men.
The other guy got out, and he also had a gun. And when I looked up, I saw the two men, and I took off running. And then they shot me.
It happened so fast. This is surveillance video of the attack. Flores says he was pumping gas when a man put a gun in his face and told him he was going to kill him. That's when Flores says he tried to wrestle the gun from the suspect's hands. Another man coming into the picture with another gun, pointing it at him as well. Flores took off running. That's when he was shot in the shin.
He didn't ask for my truck keys. He didn't ask for money. He just said he was going to kill me.
Flores refused to go to the hospital. He's still recovering from that graze wound this morning. He says he still had to go to work today. Meanwhile, Houston police are still searching for those three suspects seen leaving here in a gray or silver SUV with a sunroof. If anyone has any information, contact Houston police. Reporting in Southwest Houston, Sofia Ojeda, KPRC, Channel 2 News.
A group of would-be thieves on the run this afternoon after police say they tried to break into an ATM in Upper Kirby. It happened at a Regions Bank on River Oaks and Westheimer. The crooks damaging an ATM, but they were not able to get inside it. Police found an abandoned truck nearby that the suspects may have used in their getaway. No word how many people police are looking for. A Northwest Harris County home is now just a pile of ash after a massive overnight fire. That fire sparked around 1:30 in the North Beltway in T.C. Jester. Crews from three different departments helping to battle those intense flames. It was so strong, part of the two-story home collapsed. The cause of the fire now under investigation. Still ahead at noon, deadly tornado outbreak in Tennessee. At least 24 killed in a series of tornadoes in the Volunteer State. Coming up, a closer look at the damage and what's being done today.
And we've got a brand new severe thunderstorm warning that we'll get to here in just a sec. But the storms are moving, thankfully, when they'll be out of the area. We'll talk about that and how much more punch that is going to pack. That's all coming up.
East to Asia, countries taking new measures to control the coronavirus outbreak. We'll have the very latest next on Channel 2 News at noon.
You're watching Channel 2, Houston's home for news.
We are back with the latest on the coronavirus crisis. That virus claiming more than 3,000 lives nationwide, worldwide, I should say, including nine in the U.S. Now, although the rate of new cases continues to fall in China, concern is rising in other parts of the world. NBC's Kelly Kobayeya reporting from Seoul, South Korea.
Several countries around the world continue to struggle to contain this virus, South Korea being one of them. They reported another 500 plus new cases yet again today. 32 people in this country have now died from the virus. 41 have fully recovered, according to those official government figures. Today, some good news from the U.S. military, a commander posting an update on Facebook about that U.S. soldier and his wife who both contracted coronavirus. He said both are doing very, very well. Here in South Korea, the government is asking for huge amounts of money, $9.8 billion, to continue fighting the virus, also to counteract some of the economic fallout. In Italy, 27 deaths reported just in 24 hours, and authorities there now believe that they may have a new cluster of cases in a new town, Bergamo, northeast of Milan. They're now considering whether it's appropriate to put that town under quarantine, create yet another red zone. In Iran, 77 deaths total, according to official numbers from the government there. They've released some 54,000 prisoners from the prison system, hoping to contain the virus, stop it from spreading within the prison system there. And the WHO head has said that he believes the mortality rate from this virus, going on the cases that they have now, is higher than originally thought. It may be around 3.4%. The elderly, the older patients, much more at risk than anyone else. He also said that that number could change yet again as we continue to see more reports from throughout the world. Kelly Kobiella, NBC News, Seoul.
Tennessee is now under a state of emergency after the deadliest tornado day in 7 years. Before dawn Tuesday, 24 people were killed and hundreds of buildings were destroyed by those storms. Now, the video you're seeing now is from one of the hardest hit areas, Putnam County. Flattened homes and downed trees and power lines littering this area. This afternoon, search and rescue teams are combing through the rubble in the hopes of finding 21 people who are missing.
Our prayers are greatly needed for families out there who are dealing with a sudden tragic event.
The National Weather Service also in the state today to determine the scale and intensity of the tornadoes in Putnam County. Our Roseanne Aragon is on the ground with live reports on the deadly tornado outbreak. She'll bring you the latest on recovery efforts and the search for the missing in our later newscast.
Oof, that's a lot of people to be missing still.
And it's this time of year we're approaching, mm-hmm. which is going to pick up.
It'll start picking up as well. The two earlier in Germantown, those were rated EF3s. Wow. I have no reason to believe that won't at least be that, even if not higher. I mean, that is just flat.
So sad.
Yeah, it really is sad. So, you know, certainly look for Roseanne. She'll be in the newscast later on this evening. We've actually got some action out there right now, too. In fact, our little storm system around Montgomery has now moved its way towards the I-45 corridor and New Waverly. So we've got one severe thunderstorm warning on that track. I'm going to show you what it is. We'll jump in a little tighter on that. Two different things to note that we've got going on here. We've got a boundary coming in from the west. We've got one kind of coming in from the, we'll call it the west-northwest. So they're colliding, and where that collision is where we're seeing that severe thunderstorm warning. In fact, this is the system itself. There is New Waverly. It's passing right overhead. If you're there, heads up. Polk County, you're next. That'll be pushing its way toward Shepherd, Livingston areas here in just a bit. And, of course, you see right around Huntsville some heavy rain. Now, this has been dropping. The red areas in there just checked with flood control. It's about an inch, and it's been all within the past hour. So that does mean Lake Livingston, if you're in Livingston, you're around the Corrigan area, anywhere between, I'd say, the next 15 to 30 minutes. These have been clocking about 25, 30 miles an hour. So they're moving fairly quickly. So not as much of a flood concern, but still, there's a lot of lightning with those. We've seen some pea-sized hail as well. It just got picked up. It was right over across on New Waverly about the last 10 minutes. So there is a potential that you could see some of that. And this is all just part of this big system, this area of low pressure, what we call an upper level low. Think of it as sort of like the lawnmower that's driving everything at the surface. So as that continues to sit and spin, it taps into that Pacific moisture. Now, what's interesting is I'm going to turn the water vapor loop on because I want to show you something. The water vapor loop shows you the amount of moisture in the atmosphere. Whenever we get this kind of copper color, that's a lot of dry air that's getting pulled into the center of this rotation. So the center's right there. It's sucking in all that dry air, and I think that's what's cut off our moisture stream. Notice that the majority of the real bright colors, which is where the heaviest rain potential could be, is all pushing away from us. So I think this may be near the end of this. Now, that said, it is still fairly wet outside. Here's a live look in Galveston. They are going to be looking at some light rain, nothing heavy. I don't think it's going to be anything severe. But right now, the temperature's there in the 70s, where we've already had the rain come on through. We are in the mid-60s. Brenham, Columbus, Navasota, Huntsville's a 59. About that with rain cooled air, and we expect this to continue at least to push on through over the next 2 to 3 hours. If you live south of I-10, you may not see much more than just a couple of sprinkles out of this, but the good news is that we should be looking at a much drier, certainly cooler, still cloudy drive home tonight. If you're heading out to Rodeo, we should be fine. Most of the real heavy stuff, if there is some that regenerates, will stay north of us, and eventually that low swings through the state. And by tomorrow morning, we're talking about mid-50s to low 50s. And then how about this? A very comfortable looking afternoon. We'll see sunny skies and temperatures will be back up into the low 70s. And that's pretty much how the rest of the forecast week is going to lock in. So if you know, if you're looking, you're like, okay, maybe I won't head out to Rodeo tonight, tomorrow, picture perfect, 68 to about 70 degrees, low 70s, nice cool starts both Friday and Saturday morning, looking good right around 70 degrees as well, and then a little unsettled next week, but we've got literally the next 12 hours, we get this system out of here, we're good after that.
I don't think the weather today is going to stop anybody from going to see Willie.
I was
going to
say, look, Mr. Nelson doesn't care if it's raining
or
not.
That's
right?
Going to be packed.
It is going to be packed. It's going to be a good show tonight.
Thanks, Justin.
You bet.
Well, coming up today on Houston Life, get your fast food kick without feeling guilty. Plus, the rodeo now in full swing. Derek and Courtney have tips and tricks for the entire family to enjoy the event. They're joining us live in the studio right next door with a preview. Hey, guys.
Hey, Sion. And you know, taking the whole family out to rodeo, such a good time. Sometimes parents or caregivers might stress out about taking the kids out to rodeo, but have no fear. We have got 10 tips you can't miss. Like, did you know you can bring your own food and drinks onto the grounds, not into the stadium, just to clarify. Wednesdays are family days with special deals on junction entry and a bunch of food option deals as well.
Okay, you know what? You know what's even more amazing when you're talking about toys? You're talking about a unicorn or a shark. Check me out. Bubbles, these are all,
Okay.
We have bubbles attached to it, but Shannon Fritz, our friend from Learning Express, she's here today talking about all these amazing toys that'll keep your kids and everybody else entertained. She always has the best list. We have scooters, we have these, we have inflatable T-ball, everything that will keep everybody happy. When the kids are playing and happy, moms are happy too.
A unicorn who blows bubbles. I never knew we needed that. Also coming up today, do you think it's impossible to eat healthy when it comes to going through the drive-thru? Well, it's not. We're going to go through the drive-thru at Burger King and also share how you can create this meatless burger at home.
I like it.
Bring your appetite and your unicorn bubble blowing thing, Sion.
I'm going to be over for a play date in about 10 minutes.
Come on over.
See you then. All right, same-day delivery has been a thing for a while now, but Amazon is speeding things up. Coming up next at noon, the program it's launching to get customers their goods in just a few hours. Amazon says it is speeding up its same-day delivery program in select cities. Prime members can now get faster same-day delivery in Philadelphia, Phoenix, Orlando, and Dallas. Free delivery on up to 3 million items is available. Those items are marked today by Amazon, even giving customers the option to get deliveries first thing in the morning. Orders can be put in as late as midnight for delivery by the next morning between 4:30 and 8 o'clock. No word when we will see this quick delivery here in Houston. BMW getting in on the electric car game and unveiled the concept for its new electric sedan, the i4. The four-door vehicle can go from 0 to 60 in 4 seconds. It tops out at 124 miles per hour. That car expected to start production in 2021. Shopping for health insurance can be frustrating, but tonight at 10, consumer investigator Bill Spencer shows you a different way to get the coverage you need at a discount.
So, Bill, we started Sidecar to lower the cost of health insurance for everybody in America.
He is a man who's taking on the health insurance industry and turning it on his head to save you money.
And that blew my mind that at the same location with the same doctor, I could pay $1,300 through my traditional insurance or I could pay $330 cash.
A low-cost insurance plan where you pick any doctor you want and you decide exactly how much you want to pay each month.
We were able to go from a potentially $600 a month bill to health insurance for him that would be $180 a month.
A brand new way to buy health insurance tonight at 10.
A live look outside now out over the Southwest Freeway. Things looking very soggy and gray out there. Justin's got a final check of your forecast coming up. A brother delivers a surprise on his sister's wedding day, but it wasn't exactly a gift that was on the registry. Take a look. Her brother bringing a real live llama as his plus one. Yeah, at least he's dressed nice. Well, you can see the gag started 5 years ago when the two were riding the car. His sister was talking and talking and talking about wedding planning, so much so that he said, if you make me go to your wedding, I'm gonna bring a llama. And as you can see, he kept the promise.
Wow.
Those aren't pajamas in that llama. That's a tuxedo.
That, listen.
The llama jumped.
That llama,
pajamas.
That llama is all pimped out. Well
done. Look, he's got the fun sunglasses.
I know, right? Well done, buddy.
That's a party animal, that llama.
Oh, my gosh.
He should be
no llama drama there, right?
Not at all. That's it for Channel 2 News at Noon. We'll see you again at 4. We'll have updates on the weather throughout.
Yeah, watch out for that as well. We've got one storm up near New Waverly. We'll watch that guy head over towards Livingston. Other than that, things will start looking better here probably within the next, I'd say, hour,
right,
90 minutes.
Let's go find a llama. They're fun, right?
Let's do it.
All right. Have a great day.